Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Just give me a second, Vipula. Good evening, everyone. And welcome to another case-based discussion in this series of lectures conducted by PEMSA. I'm sure all of you all are actively participating and reaping the benefits of these lectures, which the consultants have gone through a lot of trouble preparing for you. So today we will focus on psychiatry, and it's my pleasure to introduce my friend, colleague and batchmate, Dr. Vipula Vijayasiri. He doesn't need a special introduction to this forum. All of you are really familiar with sir. So without taking much time, I will hand over the stage to Vipula, and please feel free, you know sir very well, so towards the end you can clarify any doubts pertaining to this discussion or any other concerns that you have. Over to you, Vipula.
Thank you for the introduction, Sairi. Right, okay. So let me share my screen. Okay, so our topic is social withdrawal. So I would like this to be a discussion rather than a lecture. So since some of y'all have already done the appointment, and you have a young man. With assisting him, right? Okay, so think of a differential diagnosis before you start. What are the differential diagnoses? Guys, what are the differential diagnoses that you would think of? Can you hear me?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. We can hear you.
We can hear you, Vipula. Only thing is,
there's a
slight
good
disturbance. I'm not sure whether it's coming from your end or whether it is...
Keep the video switched off. In that case, maybe the correction
maybe
is...
Maybe, shall we try that?
Right. Yeah. So students, y'all can actually... Yeah. Okay, good. Social phobia. Okay, schizophrenia. I would prefer you all to speak out rather than putting it on the chat, right?
Okay. Social phobia.
So I'm not going to read the chat, right? Social phobia, good.
Agoraphobia.
So we have agoraphobia, okay, possible.
Depression.
So we have depression, we have schizophrenia, we have social phobia, and we have agoraphobia. What else?
Anxiety disorder, sir.
What else would you think? Okay, now you. Now the parents have brought this, let's say a 19-year-old to you all, and they have seen that this person is, this child, this not a child, I mean, this man is a bit withdrawn. They are not, he's not interacting with, right? So, depression, good. Social.
Maybe he's on the
autistic spectrum. What do you think?
Spectrum, sir. Autistic spectrum. What is that?
Okay, you can think of that. Or ASD. Or autism. What else?
Drug abuse.
Now, if it has been a pervasive thing, sorry. The last. Okay, autistic spectrum disorder, you can consider if it has been a pervasive thing, it has been there for a long period of time, if there had been some changes since childhood and it has been there for a couple of years, then definitely you need to consider that. But let's say the social withdrawal, they have started to notice during the past 5 or 6 months.
Anxiety disorder, sir.
Okay, body shaming. Yeah, okay, body dysmorphic. Sorry. Dysmorphic is. They might be withdrawn. Substance, right? I wanted you to come with, that's a place where they would be. Can you all hear me? I think maybe there may be a connection with my problem. That's why it's getting disconnected. Can you all hear me now?
Yes, sir. We can hear you. Previously, the connection was breaking, sir.
Yeah. Okay. I'm sorry. I think there's some technical issue and the connection is breaking. So, okay. Now, substance misuse. That's something you need to take seriously. Right? Anything else that you would think of? Along with substance abuse, now given the scenario that you see these days, anything else that you would consider in this time? In
video game addiction. Video
game. Gaming addiction, right? That is something that we see very commonly these days, right? Spending their time, most of the time inside their room, they're not interacting with the family. And when they when you inquire into the history, you find out that they are addicted to gaming, right? Gaming addiction, quite possible. Anything, any other possibility?
Anxiety disorders, sir?
Yeah, anxiety disorders, especially social phobia and also agoraphobia can result in this kind of presentation. Right, I think y'all came out with most of the possibilities. Apart from that, you might have to think whether, especially if this has been a long-term thing, you might have to think whether that's kind of a personality or a temperamental characteristic. You might be an introvert, right? And then prefer solitary activity. So that might, that is also a possibility. Then schizoid personality disorder, right? Of course, 19 years, 20 years, personality is just forming, but still personal traits would emerge by about that time. So schizoid personality also you might have to consider. And the other thing, always keep in mind about the possibility of an organic condition, right? So these are the possibilities that you need to think of when you initially see this patient, so that you need to try and rule these out while you take your history and then do the mental state examination and other investigations, appropriate investigations, right? Physical examination and investigations. So again, let's go through the possibilities list. And if there's anything else that anybody else can think of, please, y'all are free to come out with it. So it could be, the person could be an introvert as a personality characteristic, he may be having social phobia, maybe depressed, substance abuse, gaming addiction, or it could be first episode of psychosis, right? Schizophrenia. Then it could be schizoid personality, could be an organic condition. Then agoraphobia, autism spectrum disorder, body dysmorphic disorder. So all these possibilities are there, right? So think of them before you start, right? Because otherwise your history taking would be an exercise where you collect a lot of unnecessary information. So when you think of a DD, it helps you to take a focused history. And by the end of your history taking and the mental state examination, you need to narrow these differential diagnoses down to maybe 3 or 4 most likely differential diagnoses, right? Okay, so so think of a differential diagnosis. Then ask for other presenting symptoms along with the social withdrawal. He may come with other presenting symptoms. So let us look at the common presenting symptoms of some of these conditions that we talked about, right? Now, if it's just a personality characteristic of being an introvert, then of course you might not find any other significant presenting symptom. In social phobia, they might come out with other somatic symptoms of anxiety, somatic and cognitive symptoms of anxiety in social situations. So they might describe that when they go out in social situations, they become anxious and they feel the physical symptoms of anxiety. So that might give you a clue. Then, if it's depression, of course, they might come out with the depressive cognitions, right? Being hopeless, being pessimistic, right? And then there could be other symptoms associated of low mood, lack of energy, lack of interest and enjoyment. You know, the common, you know, the depressive symptoms, so you might have them. Then in the case of substance abuse, of course, they might have withdrawal symptoms. They might present with other important things like other associated important behavioral issues like stealing money, then and all that sort of thing associated with substance use problems. If it's first episode psychosis, right, then they might have psychotic symptoms, hearing voices, then being fearful, being paranoid, being suspicious about others. Those kind of things could be there. Then, of course, in gaming addiction, right, when you might not have, you might, again, in gaming addiction also, there might be certain withdrawal symptoms. In that sense, if the parents criticize their gaming, if the parents try to stop their gaming, they will become very irritable. They might become aggressive, right? And sometimes they would have associated depressive symptoms. Then agoraphobia, of course, they might go out with their parents or someone else, a brother or sister or sibling. So they might not go out alone, but they might go out with somebody in the family. Autism spectrum disorder, of course, there would be a pervasive presentation of being withdrawn, and also there might be other symptoms like lack of appropriate emotional responses, right? Having narrowed interests. So those two things would be there. In body dysmorphic disorder, of course, they would have a concern about their appearance, right? It might be regarding their entire appearance, so it might be regarding a specific part of their body, like thinking that their nose is knocked out, it's not straight, or if their eyes are not symmetrical, something like that. So there could be other associated symptoms, associated presenting symptoms that might give you a clue towards a possible differential diagnosis. Right. Okay, any questions, Aparna? Right, so now, as you all know, in assessing a patient with mental health issues, you need to ask for the reason for presentation. So despite, now sometimes a patient might have had symptoms for a long period of time, but they may have come now because there's a specific reason, right? There might have been an episode of aggression. There might have been an episode where he has broken household items, something like that, right? So, or else there might be some legal issue leading to the presentation. So ask why is this person presented to me now, right? So that is very important. Why is this person presented to me at this particular moment? So you have to always think that. So try and find out the reason for presentation. Then you'll have to analyze each of these presenting symptoms. Now, of course, we have one presenting symptom, that is social withdrawal. Then, as we discussed earlier, depending on the possibility of different diagnosis, you might have some other associated presenting symptoms. So take each of these presenting symptoms and analyze them further, right? So you know how to analyze the symptoms. You'll have done that in taking histories in medicine or surgery, right? Like onset, duration, progression, aggravating factors, relieving factors. Now, all these aspects might not be relevant to a psychiatric symptom, but whatever that is relevant, you need to gather the details and analyze the symptom, right? Then look for important associated symptom clusters, right? Now, again, all these symptoms might not be relevant for each and every person, but keeping these things in your mind would help you not to miss important symptoms right now. So if you take patients with mental health issues, they might have symptoms belonging to some important clusters. So keeping that in your mind would help you to look for them and not to miss important symptoms. So on one side, we have the positive symptom cluster, right? Positive symptoms are things like delusions, hallucinations, right? So look for them, right? If they are not in the presenting complaint, presenting symptom, if the person does not come out with a positive symptom as they are presenting complaint in your history, ask from the patient and see whether he has any of these symptoms belonging to the positive symptom cluster, right? Then, of course, there could be negative symptoms. Negative symptoms are things like, of course, there's one in this patient. Social withdrawal is one, right? Lack of motivation, apathy. So look for negative symptoms. Then you have cognitive symptoms, right? Cognitive symptoms are things like forgetfulness, reduced attention and concentration. So in a lot of psychiatric conditions, there's a certain degree of cognitive impairment. It might be a subtle cognitive impairment, but still that could be there, right? For example, in schizophrenia, there are problems with attention, there's problems with working memory. So they could have cognitive symptoms. Then they might have affective symptoms. Affective symptoms are things like low mood, anxious mood, right? Basically mood symptoms. Low mood, anxious mood, irritable mood, then perplexed mood, right? Especially you might see that in first episode of psychosis. So look for affective symptoms. Then you have behavioral symptoms. Behavioral symptoms are things like aggression, right? Disorganized behaviors, then hoarding behaviors. Okay, so those are behavioral symptoms. Then they might have biological symptoms. Biological symptoms are things like impairment, reduced sleep, reduced appetite, then loss of libido, lack of energy. So these are biological symptoms. So look for important symptoms in belonging to these different clusters, right? So this is just a guide for you all to keep these in mind so that you will not miss any important thing, right? So one important thing is don't go to the exam and say that in my cluster analysis or symptom analysis or systemic, because there's nothing like that in standard psychiatric histories. This is just a guide for you all to keep this in mind so that you not forget about these important symptoms, right? Clear? Any questions? Any questions up to that point? Guys, can you all hear me? Are you all sleeping? Any questions?
No, sir, we can continue.
Okay. Right. So, okay. Then also look for any risks associated, right? So, there may be already instances where some risky behaviors have been there, right? So for example, person might have already tried to harm themselves, right? If there's an episode of deliberate self-harm, right? If there is an episode of violence towards somebody, right? If there's an episode of being aggressive and breaking household items. So you need to look for that, because you need to always remember past violence is a very good predictor of future violence, and past deliberate self-harm increases the risk of future deliberate self-harm as well as completed suicides, right? So always look for any risks that is associated with the person's presentation. Now, when we talk about risk, it's not only about the suicidal and the violence risk. There are gamut of other risks that you need to think of, right? So medical risk, then risk of neglect, then risk of overspending, risk of being exploited, right? So all those, then risk to the reputation. So all these various types of risks are there, but the most important ones are the violence risk, suicidal risk, then medical risk, risk of neglect. Of these risks, when you are gathering details, and see whether your patient has any of those risks, and you need to note them. Then you need to assess functional impact of this presentation, right? Basically, functional impact, what you look for is what are the things that the patient is not doing because of the symptoms. And what are the things that the patient is doing because of the symptoms? So you need to look at both these aspects, right? For example, because of the symptoms, patient might not be interacting with others. So that is obvious from this presentation. Patient might not be doing household chores. Patient might not be attending to his education. Patient might not be attending to his occupation. So this is functional impact of the symptoms, right? So you need to gather that detail and represent that as well when you are presenting your case. Right. Then family history is very important, right? Because now this is a patient presenting at a young age, right? So genetic contribution is quite possible. So look whether there is family history of a significant mental illness or a significant medical illness that might have psychiatric symptoms, right? So you have to look at both those aspects. Then when you take the personal history, you'll have to start from the prenatal period up to now, right? Especially since we are thinking of some differential diagnosis like autism spectrum disorder, they might taking a detailed personal history, especially detailed history of the childhood and adolescent period is important, because symptoms might have been there from that period and it might have been missed up to now, right? So take a detailed personal history. And a lot of conditions would have some etiological association with an event that might have happened in the prenatal period or a immediate postpartum period. But that might not be obvious, but still those events might be etiologically important. So you need to get that detailed history. And of course, the current living circumstances is very important, right? So you need to take all that detail up to now. Since we are thinking of substance as a high likelihood, right? And also regarding gaming, you need to take a detailed history regarding that. One very important thing is that unless you ask, you will not identify substance related issues in young adults, right? You need to ask. They might not come out. They might not volunteer, right? So you need to ask about. So ask about all the common substances that that is there, right? So nowadays, a very common thing in young adults is misusing prescription medication, right? Especially pregabalin abuse is rampant. So you need to ask about these things, right? So look at now, especially in this young adult age group, heroin might not be that common, right? Of course, you can't say it's not common, it's there. But more than heroin, cannabis is a very common substance abused. And then crystal meth, again, a very common thing among the young adult crowd. Then, of course, pregabalin, right? And then there could be other substances. Tramadol abuse was quite common some time back, but now that has gone down a little bit. So ask about the substances as well as prescription medications that they might be abusing. Then gaming addiction. Now, unlike substances, the parents might not realize their child is addicted to gaming. Now, for substances, of course, if the child is using them, if the parents notice that, then they would definitely bring the person to a doctor and try to get some help as much as possible, right? But that might not happen in some instances, but in most of the instances that would happen. Whereas in gaming, the family might not realize that the person is addicted to gaming, right? They might think they are doing online education or some online, okay? So you will have to take a detailed history from the patient itself to see whether he is addicted to gaming. Okay, so possible there could be organic etiology. So take a detailed medical and surgical history. Now, think of a organic condition that might present in this manner. Now, okay, I'll give a any common organic condition that might present in this manner.
Hypothyroidism.
Yeah, hypothyroidism, right? Very common one. Anything else?
Facial surgeries.
Okay. If the person has underwent facial surgeries, that might give clues regarding two things. One is that there's a possibility of body dysmorphic disorder and he might have undergone plastic surgery. On the other hand, it might be something like velocardiofacial syndrome, where correction surgeries might have been done, right? So taking a detailed medical and surgical history is important. Forensic history, then, because there might be risks associated with the presentation, right? Especially in the case of substances, there might be petty thefts. He might have been convicted. So all those cases are important. Premorbid personality and temperament. More than personality, it is temperament. If it's 18, 19 year old, you need to see whether there's a pervasive pattern of being withdrawn, right? So if there's a pervasive pattern of being withdrawn since the childhood itself, in the early adult life, early young adult life, then it could be either due to having autistic spectrum disorder, or it could be introverted personality traits, right? So an introvert is a person who would prefer solitary activity, right? But they will not have significant anxiety as such when they go out. It's because they prefer to be alone. They might be withdrawn from the other people, right? So you need to keep that in mind. Then of course, schizoid personality disorder. Still 18, 19, you might not be able to elicit that much, but still the initial personality traits might be there. Okay, so now then, as you know, you need to do a complete mental state examination to elicit psychopathology, and that would help you to narrow down your differential diagnosis. Don't forget the physical examination, right? I always tell you all not to forget the physical examination, but you always do that. Now, yesterday in the ward round, right? There was a patient with Hokum, and the students have not at least touched the patient, right? Then there was a patient with ankle edema, and the student presented the physical examination as nothing significant being there, right? So doing the proper physical examination is a must. You will that will give you diagnostic clues as well as important information for your management, right? So if you miss a significant medical risk, that might be a serious issue at the exam as well, right? So do a relevant physical examination. Don't forget that. And of course, you might have to do appropriate investigations and assessments. These investigations, of course, could be laboratory investigations or imaging investigations, depending on the presentation. So by this time, you have narrowed down your differential diagnosis. And if you are thinking of an organic possibility, then you might have to do specific investigations like thyroid functions or any other investigations that is been indicated. On the other hand, you might need to do some assessments if you are thinking of other conditions. For example, if you are thinking of autism spectrum disorder, there are some psychological assessments that you might want to do, right? If you find that there is a certain degree of cognitive impairment, you might do cognitive assessments. Likewise, there are appropriate assessment tools you might have to use depending on the patient and the possible etiology. Sorry, possible differential diagnosis. Gathering collateral information might be very important, right? Because sometimes a person like this might not volunteer information. They might not be cooperative as well. In that case, you might have to depend on the collateral information that you gather from the family members to come to a diagnosis. Okay. So, right. So, basically, what I wanted to do is for you all to start thinking of different differential diagnosis before you assessing the patient, right? We start assessing the patient and taking a focused history depending on the presentation and possible differential diagnosis. So that approach is very important. That approach is known as hypothetical deductive method of assessment, right? So that is the kind of approach that we would like y'all to develop as doctors, right? To form a hypothesis with the presentation and then to deduct or narrow down the possible differential diagnosis to few important differential diagnosis, right? Okay, any questions? guys, any questions regarding that? Shall we move on to the MCQs? Any questions? Can we move on to the MCQs?
Yes, sir. We can move on to the MCQs.
Okay.
It is clear, sir.
Right. So I have picked up some MCQs based on the possible differential diagnosis that we thought of for this presentation, right? So, these are true false type MCQs. So I would like you all to give the answer for this, and then we'll discuss. So the first one, somatic symptoms of severe anxiety include impotence. What do you think?
True, sir.
Okay. It's true, right? They might present with erectile dysfunction, right? Now, the most common cause of erectile dysfunction, especially in younger age group, is performance anxiety, right? So, they're anxious about their performance, and because of that, they have erectile dysfunction. So, in severe anxiety, also erectile dysfunction could be there. Diarrhea.
True, sir.
Diarrhea and loose motion is a common symptom of anxiety, right? So, constipation.
True, sir.
True, right? It's kind of a paradox, but both diarrhea and constipation can occur, right? Hyperventilation.
False.
Hyperventilation is false, right? Because it's hyperventilation, right? What happens in anxiety is people start hyperventilating. Sighing?
True, sir.
Right? In anxiety as well as in depression, you see people sighing. Autochthonous delusions are synonymous with primary delusions. An autochthonous delusion is one type of a primary delusion, right? So when you say synonymous, there is a bit of an issue. Okay. But on the other hand, there are two things. Now, the term autochthonous delusions is used in some places for what we call a sudden delusional idea, right? Which is one type of a primary delusion. Okay? If you take in that sense, you can't say it's synonymous with primary delusions. On the other hand, autochthonous, term autochthonous is used to say that this particular thing has occurred without any other thing, another symptom leading to it. In that sense, it's synonymous with primary delusion. So it's not a good question actually, but you can take this as a true answer. I hope I didn't confuse you, right?
Sir, can you repeat that?
Okay. autochthonous, right? In some places, that word is used to denote a delusional idea, which is one type of a primary delusion, right? In some other places, the word is used to say that these delusions are not occurring due to something else, which in that sense, it's a primary delusion, right? So this answer, autochthonous delusions are synonymous with primary delusions, you can take as true. Okay?
Okay, so thank you.
Reality preceded by delusional atmosphere.
False.
It's false, right? Because autochthonous delusions, they are primary delusions. They are, even if it's a sudden delusional idea, or whether you use it to denote all the primary delusions, that means they don't occur secondary to something else. Right? Okay, so it's not preceded by delusional atmosphere. A source of secondary delusions. Autochthonous delusions are a source of secondary delusions.
True, sir.
That's true, right? A primary delusion can be a source of secondary delusions. Pathognomonic of schizophrenia.
False.
It's false, right? There is no pathognomonic symptoms of schizophrenia. You can't diagnose schizophrenia based on only one symptom, right?
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, stem B, it says reality preceded by, so can't we take it as true?
No, even rarely you can't take, because now autochthonous means it occurs by itself, right? It's a primary thing. It's not secondary to something.
Right? Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Right. Autochthonous delusions are, within inverted commas, brain waves.
False.
That is again actually not a good answer, right? So this particular term, brain waves, is used in certain literature as an as been described by patients, right? But that's again a kind of there's a cultural context to it as well, right? None of our people will come and say that me ulwe tarangayak wage giya ehema kiyanne naha, right? So it's very rare. Anyway, primary delusions are rare anyway, and these kind of descriptions are rare, even rarer in our culture. But people in Western cultures describe these kind of scenarios, they might use terms like brainwaves. It's not a technical term, so it's not a good question. But since this has been mentioned in literature, you can take it as true, right? Normal experiences include Jameshu. What do you think of that?
True, sir.
That's true, right? The Javu, Dameshu, Jameshu, all these can occur as normal experience. Now, especially when people are really tired, right? If they're exhausted, they might get these kind of experiences. Delusional perception.
False, sir.
False.
That's false, right? Delusional perception is not a normal experience, cannot be a normal experience. Derealization?
False.
Did someone say false?
Yes, sir.
It's true, right? Derealization can be a normal experience, right? Feeling as if the environment is unreal. That can happen again when people are exhausted, tired, they might feel like that. Visual hallucinations?
True.
That's false, right? Visual hallucinations are not normal experiences. And visual hallucinations, especially if they are there, you need to always think of a organic etiology, right? And try to exclude that possibility. Deja vu?
True, sir. Sir, can tactile hallucinations be a normal experience? Tactile hallucinations, can they be normal experience?
No. Right? Hallucinations are not normal experiences. Right? Whereas pseudo hallucinations could be a normal experience. Imagery could be a normal experience. Right? Whereas true hallucinations are not considered as normal experiences.
So what about this hypnagogic and hypnopompic? If they manifest as visual hallucinations, can we take this as true? Right?
Yeah, those are special situations, right? Hypnagogic, all hypnagogic, hypnopompic hallucinations are normal phenomena, right?
So in that situation, so visual hallucinations are if it's coming as a hypnagogic one, then that would be a normal experience.
Then that would be the answer would say it's a hypnagogic hallucination, right? Hypnagogic and hypnopompic phenomena are totally different ones, right? They are normal phenomena, but if somebody wants to ask you about that they would specifically say that it's hypnagogic and hypnagogic or hypnopompic.
All right, sir. Thank you.
Right. So, what about deja vu?
True, sir.
Okay. What is deja vu? Deja vu again, like what they got true again. Deja vu is people think that something or a series of events or something they have already experienced, they have already seen that. That is a normal phenomenon. Okay.
So what is the difference between deja vu and deja vu? What is the difference between deja vu and deja vu?
Now they are almost similar, right? So, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can.
Yeah. So they are almost similar. There's a slight difference in the terminology, right? So Now, it says that a sequence of events have been lived through before. Deja vu, right? Fornication. Fornication is the medical term of fornication. Is that true or false?
False.
Hmm?
False.
Hmm. Okay. May be seen in delirium.
True, sir.
Right. It's a passivity phenomenon.
False.
Right. So it's a passivity phenomena generally. A thought abnormality, whereas formication is related to a sensory abnormality, right? Is a tactile hallucination?
True, sir.
Right. Maybe call the cocaine bug?
True, sir.
Right, okay. You know, in cocaine, people who are who abuse cocaine, they get somatic hallucination, and that's given the name cocaine bug, right? Pseudo hallucinations occur in BPD, borderline personality disorder.
False.
That's true, right? In borderline personality, you find that they have what we call pseudo psychotic episodes, right? They might present with pseudo hallucinations. They might even present with brief true hallucinations. Sometimes they might have paranoia, right? So in borderline personality disorder, pseudo hallucinations can happen. Hypnagogic states. Hypnagogic states?
False.
Oh, it's true, right? Pseudo hallucinations can occur in hypnagogic states. Hypnopompic states?
True.
True, sir.
True, right? In bereavement?
True,
sir. Bereavement hallucinations are generally pseudo hallucinations. Fatigue?
True.
Right? So pseudo hallucinations can occur in any of these conditions. Psychotic depression may be characterized by delusions of illness. Psychotic psychotic depression may be characterized by delusions of illness.
True, sir.
True, right? They might have delusions of, they might think that they have a serious illness, their bubble is rotten, they have a cancer or something like that. Jameshu?
False.
It's false, right? So it's not a characteristic feature of psychotic depression. Visual hallucinations?
False.
False, right? Again, although it's a psychotic symptom, it's not a it's not a characteristic feature of psychotic depression. Nihilistic delusions?
True, sir.
True, right? Circumstantiality?
False.
That's false, right? Again, not a characteristic feature of depression. Delusional perception? Has two stages. Delusional perception has two stages.
True, sir.
That is true, right? Is an autochthonous delusion. Delusional perception. That is true, right? So earlier we said autochthonous delusions, the term can be used as primary delusion, synonymous with primary delusion, right? So delusion perception is a primary delusion. It's often preceded by delusional mood.
False.
It's false, right? Because it's a primary delusion, it cannot be preceded by anything else, right? Okay. Occurs secondary to a hallucination.
False.
False, right? Delusional perception is a secondary delusion.
False.
False, right? Pseudo hallucinations. Are subject, pseudo hallucinations are subject to conscious manipulation.
False.
It's false, right? Now, pseudo hallucinations, you can't voluntarily control. Conscious manipulation means whether you can voluntarily control. Are dependent on environmental stimuli.
False.
That's false, right? So, hallucinations do not depend on environment stimuli. It's illusions where there is a stimuli and then misinterpretation of that stimuli. May occur in the real world.
False.
That's false, right? That is not a real thing, right? That's in your in a subjective world, may possess the vivid quality of normal perceptions.
True.
That's actually false, right? Pseudo hallucinations do not have the vivid quality of normal perceptions, whereas true hallucinations have the vivid quality of normal perceptions. Okay. Arises in inner space.
True. True, sir.
Hmm?
True, sir.
That is true. It occurs in the inner subjective space, whereas true hallucinations occur in the outer objective space. Depressive psychosis may be characterized by.
Say, excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
So, what do you mean by a vivid quality?
Vivid quality is like the color, the margins. Now, when you see somebody in front of you, right, you see that person clearly located from the external other objects. The outlines are sharp. The colors are clear, right? So that is the quality of a normal perception. Okay? When you hear a voice, it's clear to your ear, right? So likewise, in a true hallucination, you get that clear, vivid quality, right? The colors, the margins, everything is very clear. Whereas in pseudo hallucinations, that level of clarity is generally not there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Clear. Right. Depressive psychosis may be characterized by. Depressive psychosis may be characterized by delusions of filth.
True, sir.
That is true, right? Delusions of poverty.
True, sir.
That's true. Delusions of guilt.
True, sir.
It's also true. Primary delusions.
False.
That's false, right? Primary delusions generally occur in first episode of psychosis, right? First episode of schizophrenia, not in depression. Auditory hallucinations.
True, sir.
Eye to eye conduct. That's basically eye to eye contact, right? Eye to eye conduct. Eye to eye conduct is usually increased in depression.
False.
That's false, right? That is decreased. It's never a sign of aggression.
False,
right? When a person is becoming angry, there's that person would stare into your eye, right? So that is an impending sign of anger. Is an essential part of psychotherapy.
True.
Also.
That's false, right? It's not an essential part, right? In some form, I mean, in sometimes in psychotherapy that might be useful, right? And sometimes you might need to train the person to keep eye-to-eye contact, especially in case of people like people with social phobia, social anxiety. Excuse me. Sorry. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
In some conditions, like in social phobia, you might have to actually get the person to maintain eye to eye contact as part of the therapy, right? But in all forms of psychotherapy, it's not essential, right? So that's false. It's not influenced by cultural factors. That's false, right? You can't say it's not influenced. It's influenced by cultural factors. In certain cultures, maintaining eye-to-eye contact is normal. Whereas in some other cultures, people don't maintain eye-to-eye contact. So that is a false. Is assessed in mental state examination.
True.
That's true, right? Eye contact you need to assess in the appearance and behavior section of your MSc. The following conditions are more common in women: schizophrenia.
False,
right? Generally, it's equally common. Capgras delusion.
True, sir.
Capgras delusion is true, right? It's more common in females. Decarambol syndrome?
True.
That's also true, right? Both Capgras and decarambols, they are true. Bipolar affective disorder?
False.
Yeah, again, it's considered as having an equal gender distribution. Depression?
True.
False.
That's common in females. What is Capgras delusion?
They feel that it's like an imposter syndrome. The people they know are replaced by some agent.
Yeah. A person thinks that somebody close to that person is being replaced by an imposter. What is decarambol?
Delusion of love, right?
Excuse me,
sir. Isn't schizophrenia common in males? Or is it 1-to-1?
It's considered 1-to-1.
Okay, sir.
First rank symptom of schizophrenia? First rank symptoms of schizophrenia are always pathognomonic of schizophrenia.
False, sir.
Right? So that is false because there are no pathognomonic symptoms as such, right? You can't diagnose schizophrenia because of that. Include second or third party hallucinations.
False, sir.
False, right? So second person auditory hallucinations are not part of first rank symptoms. It's third person. Incorporate all passivity phenomena.
True, sir.
That's true, right? Exclude formal thought disorder.
True, sir.
Exclude formal thought disorder. Right? So formal thought disorder is not part of the first rank symptoms of schizophrenia. Includes incongruity of affect.
False.
That's false, right? Simple schizophrenia may be characterized by simple schizophrenia may be characterized by hallucinations.
True, sir.
That's false, right? Because in simple schizophrenia, the diagnostic criteria does not specify hallucinations, right? And generally, you don't now what you see in simple schizophrenia is there is a gradual deterioration over time, right? And you need that actually the time duration of more than a year of significant deterioration in social and personal functioning to diagnose schizophrenia, and you don't see any hallucinations or delusions being prominent there. So it's not characterized, right? So it's not characterized by hallucination. Sometimes they might have, but it's not a characteristic feature. Late onset?
True, sir.
Again, false, right? Simple schizophrenia, you generally see in the younger age group, right? You see they becoming withdrawn over a period of time. So that's quite relevant to the case that we discussed as well, right? They withdraw from others. They there are significant deterioration of their functioning, right? And generally, you see that in the young age group. Gradual deterioration?
True, sir.
True.
That is true. Social isolation?
True, sir.
Delusions?
False.
That's false, right? Obsessional thoughts. Obsessional thoughts always give rise to compulsion.
False.
That's false, right? An obsessional thought can occur without a compulsion. Are ego alien?
False, sir.
That is true, right? Ego alien mean ego dystonic. Right? Now, obsessional thoughts are ego dystonic or ego alien. They are not consistent with your psychological makeup. Okay? They are against the way that you think. That is why they are distressed. Now, if you are really worried about, if you are really concerned about your cleanliness, right? And if you get a thought that your hands are not clean, then you are distressed about it. Okay? So that is ego dystonic. Whereas delusions are ego syntonic. They are consistent with your ego. You might be distressed because of the content, but it's not because that they are against your psychological makeup. Did you understand? So delusions are ego syntonic. Obsessions are ego dystonic or ego alien. Obsessional thoughts rarely are of a sexual nature.
False.
That's false, right? Sexual obsessions are quite common. Are best treated by thought stopping.
False.
That's false, right? Thought stopping is a psychological strategy that they used in the past for obsessional thoughts, but now we don't use that. It's more thought habituation that we try to do now. Usually response to imipramine.
True, sir.
False.
That's false, right? Because you need to use a drug with high serotonergic action. Okay, so SSRI or a tricyclic with a high serotonergic action like clomipramine, whereas imipramine does not produce that effect. Obsessive rituals. Obsessive rituals respond well to behavior therapy.
True.
Now, thing is, you can't say responds well, right? Now, behave. Now the most common therapy that we use for obsessive compulsive disorder is exposure and response prevention, right? Now, ERP shows shows good results, but there are a lot of people who would not comply with therapy because they are too distressed to undergo the exposure, right? So it's kind of a very tricky situation because when you say response well, you don't know what's the response rate that they're talking about. So it's a bit tricky question. What you need to realize is that if a person participates in exposure and response prevention, if they comply with the therapy, they can get good results. But the problem is a lot of people don't comply because they're too distressed to undergo exposure, right? So it's kind of a marginal thing. Are usually antisocial.
Also?
That's false, right? Generally, these obsessive rituals are not antisocial. Rituals. They are not resistant.
False.
That's false. They are generally resistant. They are sensibly regarded.
False.
True.
That's false, right? Because the person who does it himself knows that they are not sensible. It reduces anxiety.
True, sir.
True, sir.
True.
That is true, right? It's because it reduces anxiety only that the people would continue to do that. It reduces anxiety temporarily, but over a long period of time, what happens is it strengthens the obsessional thought from occurring. Right. Okay, so there are two things that. Okay, any questions before that?
Sir, I've got a question. It's about pseudo hallucinations.
Yes.
Sir, in that MCQ, that can you explain it again? That it doesn't depend on the environmental stimuli.
Right. Okay. So if there's a perception or a stimulus in the environment, and if the stimulus is misinterpreted, that is an illusion. Okay. Clear? For example, you see a rope, you misinterpret it as a snake, then that is an illusion.
Okay, sir.
Right? Whereas hallucinations does not depend on an external stimulus for their origin. Apart from one particular situation where we have what we call reflex hallucinations. Reflex hallucination is something like that, when a tap is open and when the water is flowing, somebody starts to hear voices, something like that. Okay. So,
okay, sir.
Apart from reflex hallucinations, which is a special situation, hallucinations do not depend on external stimuli. It depends on external stimuli. It's a hallucination. It's a sensory misinterpretation, which is a illusion. Okay.
Okay.
So in sensory disorders, there are two main types. One is sensory misinterpretation. Other one is sensory deception. So hallucinations and pseudo hallucinations are sensory deceptions. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
What is the difference between delusional perception and delusion of reference?
Difference between delusional perception and delusions of reference.
Yes.
Okay. Now delusions of reference means that people believe certain things that they see in the environment are referring to them. For example, a person sees a group of people talking with each other, one another, and then he starts to believe that they are talking about him. Okay. The person sees a news item in the television and then starts to believe that news items refers to that person. Then he might listen to a song on the radio and then start believing that song is about him. So that is delusion of reference. Okay. That is basically thinking some unrelated external thing is referring to that person. Okay. Whereas in delusional perception, what happens is there are two components. One is a perception, and then there's a delusional interpretation. For example, you see a poster on the wall, or you see an animal. And then from that particular moment onwards, he starts to believe he is the king of the country, or he has some other special power. Okay? Delusional perception is a primary delusion. That means that occurs in a situation where the person is completely normal. For example, let's say a completely normal person is walking around. He sees a dog, right? Then he gives a completely, then he starts to believe a completely different thing, like he's the king of the country. Okay, so there's a perception and there's a totally different delusional interpretation, which is generally self-referent, right? It's generally about the self, about him. Whereas in delusions of reference, it's generally not a primary delusion as such. It can occur in other people with other mental illnesses or people with other symptoms. It can occur as a secondary thing. They will not give a totally different delusional meaning as such. For example, you see a group of people talking and you start believing that they are talking about me. So that's not a completely different delusional interpretation as such. Clear?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, two things I want to talk about this thing. Schizophrenia prevalence, gender prevalence, right? One of your asked as well. So generally, historically, it was considered as 1-to-1. But then there are certain studies which shows that there is a male predominance, right? So, but in most of the MCQs, it will be taken in, as 1-to-1, right? But fortunately, we will not get MCQs like that because if there are conflict of information where certain textbooks give as 1-to-1, depending on the historical acceptance, and if some new studies give different results, we will not give MCQs like that at the exam. Right? So don't worry about it. So schizophrenia, historically, it was considered as 1-to-1, but there are newer studies which says there's a male predominance, right? Then, yeah. And deja vu, again, there's a slight difference in the term deja vu. And somebody asked deja vu and deja vu, right? So it's almost a similar thing, but there's a slight difference in the terminology. Deja vu means a kind of a very fleeting thing. You suddenly feel that you have experienced this, whereas deja vu means a more long-lasting thing, right? So primary delusions, you have delusional mood, right? Delusional memory, delusional perception, and sudden delusional ideas. So those are primary delusions. They occur de novo, right? They occur in a person who does not have any psychopathology. For example, you have a person without any psychopathology functioning quite well, suddenly starting to believe that he is the God Vishnu or something like that, right? So sudden, it occurs suddenly. Normal person walks, sees a dog, and starts to believe he is the king, right? So these are primary delusions. They occur de novo. Right, any other questions? Okay, if there are no further questions, shall we end the session there? Okay, so if there are no further questions, we'll stop the session there. Hope you all gathered something out of it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the students, I would very much like to thank Vipula sir for the wonderful session today. Actually, it helped greatly to understand and revise what we learned during the appointment, sir. Thank you very much once again, sir. I also want to thank PEMSA for giving us this amazing opportunity. Thank you and good night, everyone.
Good night.
Thank you, sir.